Good morning. Thanks for joining us this morning. We're glad that you're here, and we want to welcome you. Just a reminder that on the flap of your bulletin, you'll find the connection card. You can use that to communicate with us. If you have some questions on the message today, remember to write those down, and we'll have a chance to take a look at those as well. So please take advantage of that. Several announcements that we have this morning. Thanks, first of all, to those of you who came yesterday to help us paint. We still have some more painting to do in the building, but we got a lot done yesterday thanks to some people who came and helped out with that. So thank you so much for doing that. Want to encourage you to stay for connections today. As we're going through 1 Peter, these sections of Scripture that we're taking are so big that we really don't have a chance to cover the entire passage. So we'll be covering some things that we won't get to in the message. So we encourage you to stay for that. We have a family movie night coming up on February the 5th. Great for the whole family. You want to put it on your calendar. We're going to be showing the movie War Room. I know some of you have already seen that. If you have, it'd be worth seeing again. I know that. I know I've seen it. I'd love to see it again. We'll have movies for the kids as well. So this is a thing for the entire family. Invite some other people to come with you. This is a great way to get them just to come and really to hear the gospel through a movie. So we encourage you to come and to be part of that as well. So make sure you do that. Let's go ahead and stand and greet each other this morning in the name of Jesus then. Will you stand with us as we begin by looking at the holiness of our Lord? We're going to be talking a lot more about that this morning, and God has told us to be holy because He's holy, and so we want to focus on His holiness this morning.
Holy, holy.
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from Exodus chapter 3, and it reminds us that today as we gather here that we're on holy ground. Will you read that with me? God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses," and he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." And he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God.
Our God. rescued the world. This is our God.
Every time that we're given a peek into what it's like to be around the throne of God, we see that God's holiness is on display. Our second reading comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Will you read it with me? And around the throne, and on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come."
Yeah.
As we prepare to give, would you give your attention to the screen? Pray with me. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be that kind of generous people. We acknowledge that everything we have comes from your hand. It belongs to you. You've just entrusted it to us for good stewardship, Father. And we want to be good stewards this morning as we give to you, as we think about your holiness and who you are, Father. We give out of grateful hearts so that we can show our love to you and so that we can show that love to other people around us as we minister to them through our church body. So, Father, take these gifts, multiply them as only you can, so that you would receive glory and honor and praise, and we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Say that you're my God.
What we're here for today. We're here to worship you, to exalt you, to lift you up. So just help us to take our eyes off of us, put them on you, to allow us to maybe catch just a little glimpse of what your holiness is like. And Father, how we can fulfill that prompt, that command that you've given to us. Be holy because you're holy. Father, my prayer for all of us is that as we leave here today, that we'd understand that just a little bit better, and that you'd allow us and equip us to live those kind of lives that would bring glory and honor to you. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. I got helpers up here, huh? Getting lots of helpers. How you guys doing this morning? Come on up and join us. Sometimes. You do, huh? Tyler, why are you hiding? Well, I brought something with me this morning that you guys probably all have, right? You guys all have one of those?
Yeah.
What is it?
A helmet.
A helmet. And when do you use your helmet?
You ride on a bike.
When you ride on a bike? Yeah. What else?
On a scooter.
On a scooter?
Roller skating.
Roller skating, yeah. And why do you wear a helmet? Why do we wear a helmet? What do you think, Brim? To keep you safe, right? To protect your head? So if you fall on your head, you don't want to hurt your head, right? So it's primarily to protect our head.
Put elbows on
too, yeah. Put pads on your elbows and on your knees, yeah. And those all protect you too, gloves, yeah. But the helmet is primarily to protect our head. And I was thinking about that we also need to protect our head in a different way, and that's what goes into it, what we think about. Because the Bible tells us that whatever we think about, that's how we end up acting. So if we think about things that God wouldn't be happy with, then guess what? That's how we end up acting. But if we think about the things that God wants us to think about, then we end up acting like God wants us to. So where do you think we find out how God wants us to act? Where do we find that? What's that?
In
Yeah? How about the Bible, right? Because this is God's word to us. He tells us in here what he's like. And he tells us the things that we want to think about. So we have to read the Bible. But we also have to keep out some things that wouldn't be good. Sometimes the music we listen to, or the TV shows that we watch, or movies that we watch, those things could put things in our mind that wouldn't be, not that God wouldn't want us to have there, right? So we have to protect our minds. So let's pray and ask God to help us do that. Father, I pray for these boys and girls. I pray that they would understand more and more the importance of protecting their mind, not just their head with a helmet, but their mind, as they look at your word in the Bible, Father. Pray that we would all be good examples for them as well as adults. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, guys. Apparently, there was a young man who went in to take his driver's license exam in California, and he was great. He drove all through there, did everything just right. And the examiner said it would have been a perfect driving test except for one thing. When he got to the end of that test and got out of the car, he said out loud, "Boy, I'm glad I never have to drive like that again." And if you think about it, though, that's exactly how a lot of people who claim to be Christians live, if you really think about it. They come to church on Sunday morning for an hour or two, and they listen to a message, and they sing some songs, and even though they might not say it out loud, as they leave the church after that hour or two, and they go to live out the other 166 or 167 hours of their life, I think some of them are really saying, "Boy, I'm glad I don't have to live like that all the time. I'm glad that I can just kind of go back to the same old way of life that I've always lived through." Now, I doubt very much that any of you this morning, anyone that's here this morning, would go that far. But I think what it does point out is just how difficult it is for us to live as disciples of Jesus in this world, to do it 168 hours a week. And that's why we've been spending time in the book of 1 Peter, because Peter really addresses that whole issue. How do I live as a follower, as a disciple of Jesus Christ, not just for an hour or two on Sunday morning, but how do I do that all throughout my life, all throughout the week? As we come to verse 13 of chapter 1, Peter's going to kind of change his focus. If you look carefully, the part that we've looked at up to this point, the first 12 verses, the verbs that he uses there are primarily what we would call indicative verbs. And that's just a fancy way of saying that he's making statements there. That's what the verbs do. They're just stating facts. But as we get to verse 13, and we're going to see that this morning, the type of verbs that he uses begins to change into what we call imperative verbs. Those are commands. And what Peter's doing, what he does is he starts out by describing what our salvation is like. But when he gets to verse 13 now, he's going to begin to describe some of the duties that we have as followers of Jesus. How are we supposed to live out our lives on a daily basis? So with that in mind, go ahead and open up your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1 if you haven't already done that. I'm going to begin reading this morning in verse 13, and we'll go through the end of the chapter this morning. So 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 13. Therefore, and as we've seen before, whenever the word therefore is there, we have to understand what it's there for. He's pointing back to the reality and the greatness of our salvation. And he's saying, therefore, because you have that great salvation, here's what I want you to do. Therefore, preparing your minds for action, being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on Him as Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you who through Him are believers in God, who raised Him from the dead and gave Him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding Word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. Man, there is so much in this passage. I got to tell you, I struggled a lot with the sermon this week because there was just so much here. How do I boil this down into something that we can really use? So there's going to be a lot of stuff I won't get to cover in the message this morning, which is why I want to encourage you again to stay for the connections time, where we'll have a chance to look at some of the things that I won't get to this morning. So because we have some limited time, what I want to do is to focus on what I really consider to be the heart of the message here. We find it in verses 14 through 16. And so let's go ahead and read those verses out loud together, if you'd read those with me. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy." So Peter, what does he do here? He quotes the Old Testament because he wants to confirm this idea that we're to be obedient children who are holy in all of our conduct. That means that what he's saying here is that being holy is not just a matter of what we do at church on Sunday morning. It's not even just limited to what we would call our religious life. In fact, what Peter is saying here is the same thing that we find all throughout the Scriptures, is that God never intended that we would separate our lives into kind of two compartments. One, all the secular stuff that we put in here, and then all the religious or the sacred stuff that we put in another box over here. God never intended for us to live our lives that way. And we really see that here. That's why he says to be holy in all your conduct. There doesn't seem to be too many exceptions there when he writes that. So I believe that. I believe that our conduct should be holy. And I don't have any problem with that command, but I tell you, here's the part I struggle with. When Peter quotes the Old Testament that says, "You shall be holy, for I am holy," any of the rest of you have a problem with that command? Do you struggle with that idea? I mean, I understand how God could be holy. I understand He is holy. But how could I possibly be holy in a way that even begins to approach who He is? So when God says, "Be holy because I'm holy," I think, man, how is that possible for me even to begin to do that? In order to understand that, we have to do two things this morning. First of all, we have to understand what the word holy means. We've talked about that before, but it's good to remind ourselves again. And then we have to take these commands that God gave to be holy because He's holy, and we have to kind of put them into context so that we can understand why God would give us a command like that that seems to be impossible for us to fulfill. So let's begin with the word holy. We've defined that word a whole bunch of times before, but frankly, it's kind of easy to kind of fall back into our old ideas of what holy means. I mean, I don't know about you, but to me, the word holy kind of conjures up these ideas of this list of do's and don'ts. You know, if you want to be holy, don't drink or smoke or chew or go with girls that do. And that's kind of how we get our idea of what it means to be holy. It becomes this legalistic list of things that we're not supposed to do. And so I don't know about you, but sometimes I picture someone who's holy as kind of someone who doesn't want to have any fun, someone who doesn't even smile most of the time. But the word holy does not mean sourpuss. That's not what it means. The word that's translated holy in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Hebrew in the Old Testament, the Greek in the New Testament, both of those words just strictly mean to be set apart. That's really what it means. It conveys the idea of something or someone who is unique or distinct. And that's what it means to be holy. God is holy not because He's just like us, only better. God is holy because He's completely set apart. He's completely unique. He's completely distinct from who we are. One of my favorite books is a book called The Knowledge of the Holy by A.W. Tozier. If you've never read that book, I encourage you to do it. It's a great book about the character of God. And in that book, the author, A.W. Tozier, has these really insightful words about what God's holiness is like. Here's what he writes. God's holiness is not simply the best we know, infinitely bettered. Holy is the way God is. To be holy, He does not conform to a standard. He is that standard. See, that's what it means for God to be holy. He's completely different. He's completely above all of His creation. Now, I don't know about you, now the command for me to be holy gets a little bit scarier. But at least I know this so far, just from that definition, is that somehow this idea of being holy means that I'm to be set apart, I'm to be unique, I'm to be distinct in the way that I live my life. But in order for us to understand what that really means, we have to go back to the context where God first gave this command to be holy because He's holy. We find that in the book of Leviticus. As a matter of fact, there's a whole section from about Leviticus chapter 10 to about chapter 20 where God is dealing with this whole idea of what it means to be holy. And He kind of bookends that whole section with the command to be holy. It begins in Leviticus chapter 11 and verse 44, where it says this, "For I am the Lord your God, consecrate yourselves therefore and be holy, for I am holy." And then at the other end of that whole section, he bookends it again with the command to be holy. We find it in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 2. "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." So we see this, be holy because I'm holy, be holy because I'm holy. And then in the section in between there, what God does is He gives all these commands to the people of Israel about how they're to live their lives in a distinct, unique, set-apart manner. And in that section, He deals with everything. It's not just about religion. There's some things in there about how they're to worship, but He deals with things like, here's what you're to eat, not to eat. Here's how you're to be cured if you have a disease. Here's how you're to treat your parents. I mean, it deals with every part of life. So we see once again that this idea of being holy is not just about our religious life. It's about everything. It's about our entire life. And in that section, we know that God gave those commands to His people because that was the very best thing for them. If they would live according to those commands, then their lives would be blessed. But I think even beyond that, I think the reason that God gave those commands is because God wanted His people to live in a distinct and unique way that would separate them from all the pagan nations around them. Matter of fact, I'm sure of that because God said that. If you go to Leviticus chapter 20, just the next chapter, in verse 26, it says this, "You shall be holy to me, for I the Lord am holy," so that's what He said so far. But now He's going to give us the reason for that. "I have separated you from the peoples that you should be mine." See, when God commands us to be holy because He's holy, here's what He's saying. He's saying, if you want to call me Father, like it says here in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 17, he says, if you want to call me Father, then there ought to be some family resemblance. And because I'm unique, because I'm set apart, because I'm distinct, if you want to be my children, then you also have to be set apart. You have to be distinct. You have to be unique in the way that you live your lives. And the reason for that is because when other people around take a look at you, they're going to know that I'm God, and they're going to know that I'm a holy God. And that, I think, is possible, isn't it? It's possible for us to live unique, distinct lives that separate us from the culture around us, that demonstrate the work of God in our lives. I'm not saying that's easy, but it's at least possible. So when God says, be holy because I'm holy, that's something that is possible. And so here's how I would summarize the idea of what it means to live lives that are holy because God's holy. That being holy as God is holy means living as a stranger in a strange world. That's really what it's all about. When he says, I want you to be holy like I'm holy, he says, what I want you to do is to live like a stranger in a strange world. Let me illustrate this for you. Let's say that I was to take you and to pick you up and somehow just transport you to someplace else in the world, to a culture that was completely different than the culture in which we live today. The language the people spoke was different. The foods they ate were different. The way that the living conditions were completely different than what you experience here. Imagine how uncomfortable it would be for you to live in a place like that. Some of you have experienced that. We have some people here who have lived as missionaries in different parts of the world where, frankly, it's a little uncomfortable to live like that. And I think what Peter's saying here, he's saying that if you're going to live on this earth as an exile, because your citizenship is in heaven, that living life here on earth ought to be a little uncomfortable at times. It ought to stretch us a little bit. And frankly, if it's not, then we ought to be questioning in our lives, am I really living a holy life? Am I really living a distinct life? Am I living a set-apart life? See, if other people around you aren't noticing that there's something a little bit different about you, then again, we probably need to really begin to question, am I living that kind of life? Or have I gotten so comfortable with this world that I just kind of fit in with it and I don't stick out as a Christian? I mean, James warned us about the dangers of falling into the trap of falling in love with this world. Here's what he wrote in chapter 4, verse 4 of his epistle. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. So let me ask a few questions to all of us this morning. Because I want us to really think about this. To think about, in every area of my life, is my conduct holy? Is it strange? Is it unique? Is it set apart? Is it distinct? How about in your job? What kind of employee are you in your job? Are you the kind of employee that shows up on time every day, that puts in a full day's work? Even if all the other people around you are not doing that, even if they're not doing that and they're getting ahead in the job and maybe you aren't, are you still willing to be the kind of employee that Jesus has called you to be? Do you treat your employer with respect, even if they don't treat you with respect? How about in your marriage? Men, in your marriage, do you love your wives as Christ loved the church? Do you put their needs ahead of your own? And wives, in your marriage, do you do what the Bible says? Do you submit to the godly leadership of your husband within that marriage relationship? When you're hanging out with workers and friends and family and other people, and they begin to tell a few coarse jokes or to use some coarse language or crude language, do you just join in with them? Are you willing to just say, hey, I can't be a part of that? When they begin to gossip and make fun of other people, are you the one that joins in with that and takes part of that? Or do you say, I'm not going to have any part of that? Because God doesn't want me to do that. I got to tell you, it's been a real eye-opening experience for me to be a referee, because sometimes my fellow officials, most of whom are not believers, can get pretty crude in course. And I just have to say, by God's grace, I've never joined in with that. And it's been really interesting to watch what's happened over time, because now every time I'm in their midst. They start to do that. They're like, oh, wait, Pat's here. And they begin to back off of that because they understand there's something different about me and that I'm not going to take part in all that stuff that they're doing because God's called me to live differently. Do you remain pure sexually in your lives, even when the world around you is trying to draw you into all kinds of traps, trying to get you to engage in all kinds of sexual behavior that violates the Scriptures? Are you willing to remain pure sexually? Are you honest in your business dealings and in your financial dealings, even if nobody else is watching? Here's one that all of us are going to have to deal with here over the next couple of months. When you do your income taxes, are you honest or do you cheat? Do you declare all your income, regardless of whether you get a 1099 or a W-2 for it? Do you only take those deductions, which are legitimate, or do you make stuff up? When you go to the grocery store and they hand you back too much change, I've actually had this happen before, do you give it back or do you just keep it and go on your way? Those are just a few of the questions to get us to think about, am I really living a life that's holy in all my conduct? Am I living a life that's distinct and different and unique? Am I living as a stranger in a strange world? Now, most of those questions I just asked, they deal with our behavior, right? And so I think our natural tendency is to think, well, if I want to live a holy life, then here's what I do. I focus on my behavior. I try to change my behavior and try to make it consistent with what God's given me in His Word. But that's not the approach that Peter encourages us to take here, as we're going to see in just a moment. That's because he knew what we see demonstrated all around us in the world. That approach doesn't work. I know that. For the last month, every day that I've gone to the gym, I see that. Because there's people there that I've never seen at that gym. But because it's January, they're there. And they've decided, I'm going to change my behavior. And this year, I'm going to get healthy. I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to get healthy. I'm going to get stronger. I'm going to lift weights. I'm going to do all these things. I'm going to change my behavior. The good news is the gym's been really crowded, but by the middle of February, it's going to be right back to where it was before the start of the year. Because changing our behavior, that doesn't work if we try to change our behavior. We have to do something else. What is it? So what if changing my behavior doesn't work, what does? Well, Peter answers that question for us here. And in order to understand it, we really have to look at the structure of this passage. And this is one of those areas where you're going to have to come for connections if you want to get the whole story. I'm going to have to just summarize it for you here. What we find in this section is that Peter gives four commands here. They're all pretty obvious. There's one more that looks like a command that's really not, and you'll have to come to connections to find out which one that is. But he gives four commands here. And then with each one of those commands, he gives some supporting information. With a couple of them, he gives the reason why there's a command. So he'll say, since God did this, here's what I want you to do. So he'll give a reason. And with almost all the commands, he gives how you're to fulfill that command. The commands themselves deal with behavior. But he's saying if you want to change your behavior, there's something else that you have to do. And so we're going to focus on those. And so if I want to live as a stranger in a strange land, if I want to be holy in all my conduct, here's the key to that. The key to being holy in all my circumstances is to discipline my mind. It's to discipline my mind. That's the principle we see in verse 13. You'll notice there's a command there in verse 13, and the command is this: to set your hope fully on the grace that's going to be brought to you at the second coming of Jesus. So that's kind of a behavior, but it also has something to do with our mind. He says, set your hope fully. We talked a lot about that last week. How do we make our living hope real? We do it by focusing on what we have ahead of us rather than the things that are going on around us. So he begins there. But the command, he gives some support as to how we're to carry that out. How am I supposed to set my hope fully on that? And there's two participles here, two verbs that describe how I do that. The first one is he says that you're to be preparing your minds for action. If you're using an ESV translation, or probably some other translations have this too, you'll notice a little footnote there. And it will say that in Greek, literally what it says here is to gird up the loins of your mind. I got to tell you, I wish the translators would have translated it like that. Because that's such a great picture of what we're to do. I mean, it does, we are to prepare our minds, but what does that really mean? And I think this idea of girding up the loins of our mind really gives us a great picture. See, in Peter's time, the men would wear these long flowing robes. And so when they had to do some kind of a physical activity, if they had to run somewhere, if they had to go into battle in war, if they were going to carry a load, what do? They take those long flowing robes and they would tuck them up into their belt so they wouldn't get in the way. So what he's really saying here is you need to get rid of any hindrances in your mind that would keep you from thinking about the things of God. Anything that might distract you or get in the way about thinking about God, you need to get rid of those things. That's how we're to prepare our mind. And then the second thing he says here is that we're to be sober-minded. The word literally means to be not drunk. But since he's applying it to our mind here, what he's saying is this. You need to make sure that you keep control over your mind, that you don't get intoxicated with the mindset of the world around you. So if we take those two verbs together, I think it gives us this picture. We need to have a disciplined mind. We need to take control of our mind. We can't just let it kind of wander all around the place. Paul said essentially the same thing in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I like the picture he gives here. He says, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. So what he's really saying is, if I think about all the things of this world, the things that are against God, here's how I deal with them. I take every thought captive to obey Christ. Isn't that a great picture? Take our thoughts captive. In other words, we need to take control of our thoughts and not let our mind wander all over the place. We need to have a disciplined mind. We talked about this some last week, didn't we? We talked about the choices that we have to make if we're going to look forward to our inheritance rather than looking around at the circumstances around us. We have to choose what's going in our mind, the things that we're listening to and watching and hearing and reading. Because, as Peter points out here, what goes into our mind, it eventually comes out in our conduct. So the way we transform our conduct is by transforming our minds, having a disciplined mind. And he says there's two important ways that we do that here in this passage. The first thing is I have to close my mind to some things. I have to close my mind to the thinking of this world. Peter here gives us several reminders of what our minds were like before we came to know Jesus Christ, before we committed our lives to Him and became His disciples. Before we became citizens of the kingdom of heaven and we were still citizens of this world, there were some things that characterized our thinking, and we can't keep thinking about those things again. Look in verse 14. In verse 14, he instructs us, don't be conforming to the passions of your former ignorance. What he's saying here, before we became disciples of Jesus, we were enslaved to thinking about the passions of this world. Again, Paul points out what that means in Ephesians 2. He says, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. So there was a time when we didn't have a choice. We just got carried along by these passions of our flesh. And Peter says, you got to quit thinking about those things. You got to close your mind off to that kind of stuff because God has made you new. Verse 18, look at this. He says that Jesus ransomed us from our former way of life, a life that was characterized by futility. So Jesus ransomed us from that. He set us free. We don't want to go back to that. Verse 22, he reminds us that our souls have been purified by obedience to the truth. So he says, don't go around back to all the falsehoods that soiled your minds. They've been purified by the word of God, by the truth of God. So don't go back to that. So what he's saying in each one of these cases, don't go back to the mindset that you had before. And sometimes we need to take some practical steps in our lives to make sure that doesn't happen, don't we? I would never suggest that you just cut off all your relationships with non-Christians. I mean, the Bible's really clear we're not to do that. Why else would God leave us here on earth? He leaves us here to tell Him about Jesus. But you know what? Sometimes there are some relationships in our life that keep dragging us back to that former way of life that sometimes maybe we need to let go of those. There might be some TV shows that we really love, but guess what? Those TV shows are putting out values that are continually dragging us back into that old way of life. We need to quit watching those TV shows. There might be some music that we really enjoy listening to, but that music, again, it's dragging us back to this former way of life, and we sometimes just have to change the station or get rid of some of that music or whatever it might be. So I have to, first of all, close off my mind to the thinking of the world. But as I've talked about before, that's not enough. If we just kind of get all that stuff out of there, that's not enough. We have to fill it with the right stuff. So I have to open my mind to the thinking of God's world. And Peter here reminds us of all the things that God has done for us that make it possible for us to be citizens of His kingdom. And those are the things that we need to think about. Look in verses 18 through 21. It says here that God ransomed me at a great price. He reminds us here of the great price that God paid to ransom us from that old way of life. He didn't just ransom us with gold or silver or things of this world. He ransomed us with the precious blood of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He ransomed us at a tremendous price. Even though Jesus was perfect, He willingly died on that cross and God raised Him up from the dead so that we don't have to constantly focus our mind on the things of this world. We don't have to go back to that old way of life. It says in verse 23, the same thing we saw last week in verse 3, God has caused us to be born again. We didn't do anything to deserve it. God caused us. Because He loves us so much, He caused us to be born again. And guess what? When you're born again, what does that mean? You're born into a new life. He doesn't want us to go back to the old way of life. He gave His life on the cross so that we could have a new way of life. Why do we want to go back to the old way of life, the old way of thinking? And then in verse 23, He tells us that He sustains us with His Word. There in that verse, He's primarily dealing with what God's Word does in the whole process of salvation. But the idea here is He says God's Word, it remains forever. It's not like a flower that wilts or the grass that goes away. It remains forever. It's there because God uses His Word to sustain our life day after day. So the more time I spend in His Word, guess what? The more I fill my mind with His ways. And the more I fill my mind with His ways, the more it comes out in my conduct. So being holy, as God is holy, what does it require? It requires that I live as a stranger in a strange world. See, when my mind is constantly focused on all that God has done for me, when I'm focused on the fact that God chose me to be His child, that He's made me a citizen of His kingdom, then it ought to cause us to want to think about the things that are consistent with that kingdom. And the more we think about those things, and the more we get our minds off the things of this world, guess what? Our lives begin to line up more and more with the ways of God. And as that happens, guess what? We're going to be stranger and stranger and stranger in this world in which we live. So as we close this morning, I want to make this really practical for us. I could give you 100 things to do, but I'm gonna just encourage you to do 2 things to apply what we've learned this morning. First of all, I want to encourage you, think about, evaluate the things that you're reading and watching and listening to. And really make an honest evaluation of those things and ask this question. Are those things causing me to think about the things of God? Or are they drawing my mind back to the things of the world? And if they're drawing your mind back to your former way of life, back to the things of this world, then there's probably some things that you need to get rid of in your life. But getting rid of stuff, as we said before, isn't enough. So the second thing I want you to do is to fill your minds with the things of God by spending time consistently in His Word and in prayer. Because that's where God speaks to us. That's where God reveals Himself to us. That's where we begin to understand what His ways are. And we begin to fill our minds with His ways so that, guess what? After a while, as we continually fill our minds with those things, guess what happens to our behavior? Becomes consistent with the way that we're thinking. I think if we would all just do those two things, then we would be well on the road to making sure that we're holy in all of our conduct, not just for a couple hours on Sunday morning, but 168 hours a week, every week of the year, every year of our lives. Let's pray. Father, this is challenging stuff. When you tell us to be holy because you're holy, that seems almost impossible to us. But Father, at the same time, you would never call us to do anything that's not possible. And we thank you that through Jesus that we've been empowered to live a holy life. We thank you because He ransomed us, because He caused us to be born again into this new life, that we have the ability to change the way that we think. And as we change the way that we think, we will change the way that we act. Father, we understand that living as a stranger in a strange world is a really difficult thing to do. We need you to help us do that. We thank you that you've promised to do that. But Father, we have to first make that decision in our hearts that that's the way we want to live. And so I pray for all of us, and I'm including myself in this morning, Father, help us just to evaluate what we're filling our minds with and to make sure that we really do guard those minds. We close them off to the things of this world, and we open them up to the things of you. Thank you for that. Thank you for doing that for us in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you have any questions that you've come up, you can write those down, pass them to the middle, Ryan will collect them. Not all at once, of course. Don't see anything. Again, I want to encourage you, if you come up with questions afterwards, write them down, because we'll deal with those. Thanks again for being with us this morning. Let's stand and receive God's blessing for us this morning. Once again, as every week, as we've gone through the book of 1 Peter, our benediction comes from verse 2, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. And all God's people said, amen.